This morning, we'd like to draw your attention to the fourth chapter of the book of Hebrews. In Hebrews chapter 4, there in verse 1, let us therefore fear, lest a promise being left us of entering into his rest, any of you should seem to come short of it. Verse 9. There remaineth therefore a rest for the people of God. For he that has entered into his rest, he also has ceased from his own works, even as God did from his. Let us labor therefore to enter into that rest, lest any man fall after the same example of unbelief. For the word of God is quick, or alive and powerful, it's sharper than a two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of the soul and spirit, the joints and the marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. Neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight, but all things are naked and open unto the eyes of him with whom we have to do. Here, the Bible speaks to us about God's rest for God's people. And if I were asked to give a one-word definition of the age in which we live, as I look at the world around me, I think the one word I might use would be chaos. For we are living in a chaotic age. Everything seems to be in a state of flux. There seems to be so little that is certain and sound and sure. Another word that I would use to describe the age in which we live would be restlessness. For there seems to be a restlessness over the hearts and lives of people all around us. Every once in a while, circumstances beyond my control, I get trapped and I have to go to the shopping mall with my wife. And as she is looking for her desired merchandise, I often am looking at people. People as they go through the mall. I see the furtive looks upon their faces. I see the anxieties. I see the nervousness, the tensions, and there's just a spirit of unrest in the world today. This restlessness seems to pervade our society. But there is a rest for the people of God. And God has promised a rest for his people. But we should take care that having a promise of rest given to us, that we should fail to enter into it. Now, the word here in our text, this word rest, is a peaceful contentment. It is something that is more inward than it is outward. Inside, my heart is at rest. There's peace. There's quietness. There's assurance. Sometimes I see fellows who have eaten their lunch here on the grounds. They're lying out here under the shade of a tree. Their empty lunch pails beside them and their hats pulled over their faces, taking 5 or 10 before they go back to work. And as you see them lying there, you say, oh, he's resting. Maybe so, maybe not. You can be in that prone position, your hat over your head, lying there on the grass. But if in your mind there is racing all kinds of concerns and worries anxious about for what's going to happen when I get home this afternoon, or where I'm going to go, or what I'm going to do, then you're not really resting, though your body may be in a prone position. On the other hand, you can walk up to a man whose face is dripping with perspiration and his clothes wet with perspiration. And as he is lifting the heavy bales of hay onto the truck, you ask him a question. From the smile on his face and the look in his eyes, you know that that man is resting, even while he is throwing those heavy bales of hay around. There's just something about him, a sereneness, a contentment, a happiness, that you know that he's resting. You see, the rest that God is promising is this inward rest, the peace, the contentment, the quietness within. It's the absence of anxiety and of worry, of concern or stress. Now, we are told here that in 6 days God created the earth, and then God rested. And so God blessed the seventh day, because on the seventh day he rested. What does it mean? It means that he rested from his work of creation because it was finished. Once you have finished a task, you don't go on with the task. You rest from that task. Now, it doesn't mean that you're totally inactive, not doing anything. Far be it from that. One time Jesus had healed someone on the Sabbath day, and the Pharisees were all upset and accused him of violating the Sabbath law. And Jesus responded, "My Father is working today, and so I work." You see, even though it was the Sabbath day, the Father was still working. And he works every Sabbath day, and you better be thankful. Wouldn't it be tragic if God took a day off every week? So that if I happen to have a very serious problem come up on the Sabbath day and I go to pray, he says, "Sorry, it's Sabbath day. Come around tomorrow and we'll see what we can do." No, he doesn't take any days off. Jesus said, "My Father is working today, and so I work." Though he had rested in that the work was complete, still his work of maintaining is going on. Now, God is resting in the completeness of the work of redemption. He did not rest until Jesus came and finished that work. You remember Jesus one day said, "I did not come to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me, and to finish his work." God had unfinished business, the business of the redeeming of mankind. And Jesus came to finish that work of redemption. So when on the cross Jesus cried, "It is finished," he was referring to God's plan of redemption for mankind, that plan which he completed in his death upon the cross. So that there is therefore now no work that I can do, no good deed that I can do to redeem myself. That redemption that I experience is a finished work of God through Jesus Christ, and all I can do is to rest in God's finished work. But God help us. There are a lot of people who are not resting in the finished work of redemption through Jesus Christ. But they who have entered into that rest have ceased from their own works. It is sad to see that many men, having not accepted God's finished work of redemption, are doing their best to offer to God some good work, whereby they seek to induce God to accept them and to forgive them their sins. And these men who are seeking by their own works to establish a righteous relationship before God stretch in the spectrum all the way from the black-robed Jew bobbing in his prayers at the Western Wall to the white-shoed, flashy-tied Pentecostal holiness evangelist declaring hellfire and brimstone upon all of the women who are wearing makeup or wearing golden jewelry. These things do not save. These things do not give you a righteous standing before God. These things do not give you any favors before God. It is important that we distinguish in our minds the difference between the work of redemption and works for redemption. Because the one is completely accepted by God and the other is totally repulsive to God. The work of redemption was wrought completely by Jesus Christ upon the cross when he died for our sins. And God is satisfied in that work of redemption. It is a completed work once and for all. Those works for redemption are those things that man is doing in order to try to cause God to look favorably upon him and to perhaps forgive him his unrighteousness and sins. It is this paltry works of our flesh that we are offering unto God, seeking that God would accept them and thus accept us. But as the scripture says, by the works of our flesh shall no man be justified in the sight of God. For our works, again it says, are as filthy rags in the sight of God. It's repulsive to God. Now, there is one other work that should be mentioned. And that is the work that I do out of love as I am responding to God and his goodness to me. As David said, what can I give unto God because of all of his benefits unto me? And when I think of all that God has done for me and all of the blessings that God has bestowed upon me, the richness of God's grace that I've experienced, my heart yearns to do something to show God how much I love him and how much I appreciate all he's done for me. And so there are works that I do, but I never point to them and say, oh God, you ought to do this for me because look what I've just done for you. I don't look at my works as the basis for God accepting me or blessing me or doing anything for me. I look at my works as just the most reasonable thing I can do for God because he's done so much for me. And I always am looking at the work of Jesus for me, not my work for God. And I'm resting in the work of Jesus for me. And I'm not trying to find righteousness in my works for God. That's the least I can do after all that he's done for me, is just to give him my heart, my life, my energies, my time, that he might use me as he sees fit. But I don't look at them as making me righteous or giving me any kind of favorable standing before God. When I come before God, I never come on the basis of my works, my prayers, my devotions, or my anything. Whenever I come to stand before God, I'm standing there in the grace of God through Jesus Christ and the finished work upon the cross. And I'm resting in his finished work. Now, we are warned here that we should fear lest a promise having been given to us of entering into rest, that we should fail to enter into it. There are a lot of people today who have not entered into God's rest. A lot of Christians today whose lives are filled with worry and concern and anxiety and turmoil. We are given the children of Israel as a classic example of God's people who failed to enter into God's rest. There in the wilderness, though God had delivered them with a mighty hand out of the power of the bondage of the Egyptians, though he had led them through the Red Sea on dry ground and later drowned the Egyptians who attempted to follow them through the same path, though they had seen God's power in the delivering from the bondage of corruption and sin, yet they perished in the wilderness. They never entered into God's rest and into the land of God's rest that he had promised to give to them. And why did they not enter into that rest? Because of their unbelief. Let us beware, the psalmist said, that any evil heart of unbelief would keep us also from entering into that rest that God has for us. You see, they came right to the border of the land. Moses led them to Kadesh Barnea. They're right now ready to enter into the land, but they decided to send in 12 spies, one from each tribe, to look over the land. And as the 12 spies came back to give their report, 10 of them said, "Oh, it's a land that eats up its inhabitants. It's rocky, it's barren. And there are giants in the land. We were like grasshoppers in their eyes. And the cities are powerful and strong. They have high walls. We're not able to take it. We can't do it." But the two spies, Joshua and Caleb, said, "Hey, they're bread for us. The land is beautiful. It's well watered. Look at these grapes. We took them, just one stem of grapes, and yet it took two of us to carry them between us on the staff. Oh, it's a beautiful land, and we are well able to take it. Let's go in now." But those 10, with their evil report, brought fear to the hearts of the people. Unbelief. And they said, "Let's go back to Egypt. Let's get leaders to take us back to Egypt. We were fools to ever follow Moses." And the wrath of God was kindled against the children of Israel, and God said, "You won't go into the land. You won't experience the rest. You can wander here for 40 years until you've all died, and your children that you said you're worried about, I'll let them go in, but you can't go into the rest." And because of their unbelief, they did not go into the rest that God had. You see, they thought that even though God had begun a work and delivered them with a mighty hand out of Egypt, that they were going to have to finish the work in the power of their own flesh and strength. Now, this is the same mistake that many believers make. Having experienced the power of Jesus Christ setting them free from the bondage of sin and corruption, from the power of sin that was holding them captive, somehow they think that they have to go on and complete the work of righteousness by their own efforts and by their own works. And in our endeavor to do these righteous works and recognizing the weakness of our flesh, sometimes unbelief comes in and we think, "I can't do it." Well, God doesn't require you to do it. He has done it. The work is finished. He only asks that you believe in that finished work of Jesus Christ for you. But unbelief fills our hearts as we look at God's requirements and we say, "Oh, I can never be perfect. Oh, I can't do that." And as unbelief fills my heart, with it comes the turmoil and the striving. Stress, the anxiety, and I feel myself just all upset and restless with the world around me. You see, the only way I can ever enter into the rest is through faith. Jesus said, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him, it's through faith. When the Philippian jailer said to Paul, what must I do to be saved? Paul said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. He didn't give him a long list of rules and regulations, how many hours he should pray and how many chapters of the Bible he should read and all of this kind of stuff. He just said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. When they came to Jesus and said, what must we to do the works of the Father? Jesus said, this is the work of the Father. Just believe on him who he sent. That's all the Lord is asking. It's just your believing in the finished work of Jesus Christ. That he's done the work for you. And that by your believing in him, God then accounts you righteous. You know, we can never rest in our own works, no matter how good they may be. Because I am never quite certain of what motivated my works. Do you know your own heart? Do you really know why you've done everything you've ever done? I spent half my early childhood trying to explain to my dad why I did the things I did. Son, why would you do that? I don't know. Hardest thing to answer. The motive, the real motive of my heart. If I suppose I was really honest, I'd say because I'm a dirty, rotten, selfish stinker. You know, I don't know my own heart. I don't know what's in there. The Bible says the heart is deceitful and desperately wicked. Who can know it? I don't know my own heart. I know a little of my heart, and the little that I know scares me about the rest of me. David said, Lord, you know me, but he said, I don't. Such knowledge is too great for me. I can't attain it. You search me, God. You know my heart. You find out if there's some wickedness there. You know, if you really are honest, just painfully straight honest, if you will look at most everything you do, behind it you'll find a selfish motivation. Even some of our most generous deeds of kindness are done with the hopes that people will see how generous and kind I am and think, my, isn't he nice and generous and kind? The motive is that men might think of me in a better light. And that is why I dare not trust in my works, because you see, the Word of God is alive and it's powerful, and it's a discerner of the thought and the intent of the heart. Someday I'll be judged by the Word. And the intent of the heart will be the thing that will be judged. And who can stand before that kind of a judgment? So I dare not trust in my works because I don't always know the motivations. I do know, and this is an honest confession now, and it's not easy. I do know that a lot of the things I do are intended to cause people to think I'm a nice guy. I'm a great athlete. I'm this, I'm that, and I want people to think well of me. And a lot of things I do, I know that there is that kind of motivation behind it, and that frightens me. It frightens me enough that I know that I better not trust in my own works, because when they are tested in the fire, they may go. So I'm trusting in the finished work of Jesus Christ, because that's something that God is resting in, and so that's where I am resting. And when I come to God, I don't come on the basis of my works, because I may say, God, no, after all, you know, give me a break. I helped that little lady across the street this morning, you know, got out of my car and stopped traffic and led her across the street, Lord. You know, didn't you see that? And he will answer, yes, I saw that, but I also saw you this afternoon when that little old lady pulled in front of you. And you laid on your horn and you yelled out the window, where'd you get your driver's license? In a grab bag, you know, and I saw that one too. I dare not trust in my works. I dare not come to God on the basis of my works. My only hope is in the finished work of Jesus Christ, and there's where I rest. Lord, He did it. He paid the price. He redeemed me from my sin. And I rest in that finished work of Jesus. You say, oh, but it's so hard to rest in faith. I like to see, I like to know. Just to rest in faith, that's hard. Wait a minute. It may be hard, but that's the only place you can ever rest. The only place you can ever rest is in that complete faith in God and in His work and what He has done. The fact that God is in control of your life and the circumstances of your life and the things that surround you. That's the only place you'll ever rest, because you're not going to always understand your circumstances. Though things may be going good now and you can understand everything that's happening now and you see the plan and all, and this is great. Tomorrow, the whole thing may blow up. And you may not be able to see any rhyme or reason for life. And the whole thing is gone. And if your resting was in the fact that you could understand things are going great and all, then your rest is going to be disrupted terribly as you say, oh, what's happening? What's happening? The whole world is falling apart around me. It's only when you have that belief in God, that God loves you and that you are His child and that He is in control, sovereign control of your life and the circumstances of your life, you can take and accept anything that comes in your path and you can say, well, it's all right. God is in control. He is ruling over me and over my life. And that belief and trust in God and His control over my life, I rest in it. And nothing disturbs that rest. So the doctor says, well, it looks like it's cancer. I don't say, oh, no, not that. Oh, help, oh, God, what are we going to do? Oh, you know, and go all to pieces. Cancer, oh, no. You say, cancer, well, interesting way to go. If God so ordains, my life is His. Now, He can do one of two things. He can either heal me of the cancer, or He can take me home to be with Him by way of cancer. So if the worst thing that can happen to me is to be brought into the presence of the living God and His glory, man, I've got it made. Why should I fear? God is in control of my life and the things that surround me. And as I believe and trust in God, my heart is at perfect peace no matter what may be happening around me. What turmoil might be stirred up, my heart is at rest because I am believing and trusting in the living God that He is going to take care of me, that He's in control of the circumstances of my life. Only in faith can you find real rest. There is a rest for the children of God, but let us take care lest a promise of rest being given to us, we would not enter into it, that unbelief would keep us from that place of resting in God today, that perfect rest that He wants us to experience. As we rest in the very same place that God is now resting in, the finished work of Jesus Christ. For there is a rest for the people of God. And they that have entered into that rest have ceased from their own works. My own struggles, my own efforts. I'm resting in Him. Thank God for that rest in a restless world. Father, we thank You today for the work of Jesus Christ, the finished work, whereby we were redeemed through His blood. And now, Lord, we enter into that rest by faith. Faith in You, in Your love, in Your sovereign plan that rules in our lives as we surrender ourselves completely to You. In Jesus' name, amen. There's an interesting verse that says there is no rest for the wicked. He's like a troubled sea, a stormy sea that just is constantly breaking, crashing, moving, foaming. The wicked. Maybe you're tired of the strife, the anxieties, the concerns. You'd like to experience peace today. That's exactly what Jesus Christ is offering to you if you will come to Him. For He said, "Come unto Me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." Does that mean I don't do any more work? No, it means that He said, "Take My yoke upon you and learn of Me." The yoke was things so the ox could pull the plow, but now it's a new yoke. It's an easy yoke. It's a light burden. My yoke is easy. My burden is light. And ye shall find rest for your souls. I would encourage you to just come to Jesus Christ today. You can go back to the prayer room. The pastors will be back there to pray with you, that you might be freed from the restlessness of sin and a life of sin and come into the glorious peace in Jesus Christ. But for you who are children of God, now this scripture was written to the believers. You see, it's possible to be a child of God, to be delivered from the power of sin, but still not experience the peace of God. You're not resting in the finished work of Jesus Christ as far as your righteousness is concerned. Having begun in the Spirit, you're now trying to be made perfect in your flesh, and it's not working. And there is that restlessness within your own heart, that turmoil that is there. Believe and trust in Him completely today. Know that God has accepted you on the basis of the finished work of Jesus Christ, and God accounts you righteous. And as you realize these things, then the yoke becomes easy, the burden becomes light. The things that I do, I don't grind under my service to God. I relish my service to God. I enjoy what I'm doing for the Lord, nor do I point to it as, you know, brownie points and God, you know, do I get my award now? You know, I've hit the fifth level. But I just say, oh Lord, it's so good to be able to give myself for You. You've given me so much. And I'm resting in what You've done as I work my head off, just trying to show You that I appreciate it and I love You and I'm grateful for all that You've done. And so my works are response to God. They're out of gratitude. I'm not trying to get God to respond to me. He's already initiated everything and given me everything. Why should I want anything more? God's given me everything richly to enjoy. I just want to show Him that I appreciate it and love Him for it. Oh, come to that relationship where you're resting. Then you can truly serve. God bless you. Give you a great week. May he fill you with his Spirit, and may you walk in his love, and may you experience the peace of God that passes human understanding as you see the finished work of Christ on your behalf and you rest in God's love. In Jesus' name.